Boat, and tonight I'm joined by Fiona Sharpe, who's the spokesperson for the Sussex Jewish Representative Council. Welcome, Fiona.
Good evening.
We've had a lot of stuff in the press over the last year about anti-Semitism. You're obviously really in the front line as that spokesperson for the Sussex Jewish Representative Council in Brighton and Hove. Yep. How are things locally?
I think there is increasing tension. If you look at the latest figures around all hate crimes, sadly, all hate crimes are up in the last year. We've seen a rise in disability hate crimes, we've seen a rise in homophobia, and we've seen quite a significant rise in faith-based hate crimes, and that it is predominantly Islamophobic and anti-Semitic hate crimes.
Why do you think there's been this rise? I mean, you and others, as you said, all the other faiths in Brighton, I know you work with them all. Yep. Why, despite all your work, are the figures, the hate crimes, why are they rising?
I think we've entered an age of othering. And I think Brexit and the potential of Brexit has contributed to that. I think we have started to see society as individuals and individual cultures. We have lost the idea of this wonderful melting pot. And I think once you start identifying people as being other, as being different from yourself, then you see a rise in hate crimes. You see people taking out frustrations on people that don't look like them or don't sound like them or are visibly different. And I think, unfortunately, the figures are proving our worst fears.
Even in Brighton, which is sanctuary by sea.
Yeah, I think even in Brighton. Listen, Brighton is the most liberal, most wonderful city. And if you see all the projects going on here, only a couple of weeks ago, I was at the opening just up the road of the Rainbow Hub, which is a cross-communal space for people to come and talk about hate crimes, to report them. It's a space that had been dedicated by the LGBT community, but is open to all minorities, and it is wonderful. But unfortunately, like everywhere, we have people here who want to point out differences and who want to cause trouble between communities as well.
That's in, if anyone doesn't know, that's in St James Street, just yeah. Right in the corner, as you said. Recently, there was the vigil for the people who were killed in Pittsburgh in that very obvious anti-Semitic event. Mm-hmm. You brought together 150, 200 people outside Hove Town Hall, a very moving event, most of the faiths represented, atheists too.
Yep.
That shows there is obviously a lot of people who do want to come together and do want to unite Brighton to unite against it. Do you see us winning, in short?
I think we have to win.
Okay.
Because I think the alternative is absolutely impossible to imagine or to allow happen. I think there are enough people of good faith who would much rather live side by side than in a situation where we're hating one another. So absolutely, of course, we will win. It's not easy, though, and I think it does require people to be willing to stand up and to point things out when they see them and to stand alongside people who are maybe being victimised or bullied. And I think we all need to take greater social responsibility.
I was at the council meeting recently. I heard you speak and others, and that obviously was about the... what is it? The actual lettering?
The International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance.
IHRA.
IHRA. Yeah.
And that's the one that there was a lot of fuss about, basically earlier this summer, wasn't there? Especially in the Labour Party. But it passed in Brighton Council. Tell us how well that went.
For us, it couldn't have gone any better. It won unanimously, 47 votes for and none against and one abstention. So
pretty well everybody in Brighton on the council were supporting that.
Yeah.
So Why do you think there was the change round? Because obviously Labour were having some doubts about it before. Why in Brighton particularly did you manage to persuade everyone to vote for it?
Well, I would like to think that I'm particularly persuasive.
You are, but...
I think, actually, that the reality is that when you looked at the definition, when you looked at how important it was to the Jewish community, and you really went back and you looked at McPherson and how we define hate, and that the victim is the person that defines that hate, whether it's an incident or an actual crime, and what that threshold is. I think it was very clear that those who were against the adoption were taking a point of view that was based on politics and not on reality and not on looking at hate crime language. And I think that people are very pragmatic, and people understand, particularly politicians, that you have to look at community impact as well. And I think over the summer and over the last year, the tensions and the concerns of the Jewish community was something that certainly Brighton and Hove Council paid attention to. And I think it would appear that they listened to the Jewish community in terms of accepting language that affected the Jewish community, as is right and proper. You wouldn't ask any other community how to define homophobia or how to define racism. So it is only right that the Jewish community gets to define what is anti-Semitism.
There were people who spoke against you,
yep,
obviously. And then Dan Yates gave a very moving support, really, for your view. And as you say, that was carried by the council almost unanimously. Mm-hmm. I was going to ask you then about... I don't want to conflate the two at all, really, you know, because I think anti-Semitism is completely separate from the issue of Israel. Mm-hmm. But obviously so many people bring it together. In a sentence or two, what do you say to those people who do bring the two things together?
I think it's very easy to use one as an excuse to attack the other. Unfortunately, you know, I have a friend that tells me never to read below the line on comments in newspapers, and a local newspaper covered the vigil last night, and it took four comments before someone said, but Israel, but Palestine. And this was about anti-Semitism in the Jewish community. They are two separate things. I am a very proud Jew sitting here in Brighton. What the government of Israel does is not my responsibility, is not my business, and has nothing to do with me. That I choose to make it my business is my choice. But nobody has the right to ask me what my position is on Israel when we're discussing anti-Semitism. One has nothing to do with the other, and it's a great shame that anti-Semitism, the oldest hatred, which is based purely on religion and was the cause of 6 million people being slaughtered, has been politicised the way it has in over the last couple of years. And they are two very, very separate things.
OK. There are obviously quite a lot of diverse communities in Brighton. You work with a lot of them. Tell me something about the people and the communities that you work with, as well as the Jewish community, and how you all see each other. Because obviously, a lot of people think that, to put it in a nutshell, Muslims and Jews don't get on. What's your response to that crass view?
I think it is just that. It is crass. I think there are good and bad in everyone. I have very good Muslim friends. I have always had Muslim friends the same way as I have gay friends, people of colour, people of mixed abilities. I don't look at people based on their religion, certainly. I think that it has become difficult to have conversations with people of different religions because we're fearful of debate and of disagreement. And I think that the media would like to portray, particularly the Jewish community and the Muslim community, as not getting on. But actually, I think that is far from the truth and the reality. I was incredibly happy to see so many Muslim friends at the vigil last night who came out because they believed it was the right thing to do. Some of them, I think, came out because of the relationship that we have. And they wanted to support me and the community. In one of my other roles, I set up the Network for International Women in Brighton and Hove. And we work with about 200 women from all different faiths and minorities.
We'll talk about that after the break, because we've got to have some adverts now. So, yeah, I'm joined by Fiona Sharpe. We'll talk about that after the break. Welcome back to The Vote. I'm joined by Fiona Sharpe from the Sussex Jewish Representative Council. We were talking about women. You work with 200 women, you were saying. Carry on.
So a colleague and I had set up this organisation to support minority women, predominantly women who are immigrants, refugees. We have a lot of European and English women as well, but to end social isolation and to try and encourage women who have recently got here, who don't speak English as a first language, to integrate better in the society. And we've been running for about a year and a half now. We meet regularly. And we are women of all different backgrounds, of all different faiths, and we relate to each other as women. It doesn't matter whether you speak English or you don't speak English, whether you are Muslim or you're Jewish or you have no faith at all. I think people just want to relate to each other as human beings, and I think that's what's wonderful in many ways about Brighton and Hove, that if you want it, it's out there, and you can find people of all different backgrounds to socialise with, to work with, to go dancing with. And I think that the city is really wonderful if you look at and see what's out there. So I'm very proud of the work that I do, particularly with the immigrant women, in trying to get them better involved in society, in civil society as well. They come from very different cultures, and honouring their cultures as well, and showing them that their cultures have value and importance here as well, and how they can hold on to those as well.
I mean, I've lived here a long time. I've definitely noticed how different the city is from 30 or 40 years ago, when, to be frank, it was largely just white, you know, and it's really changed, and for the better, you know. I mean, the music is amazing, that's for sure. We had a gig here a couple of weeks ago, you know, a Syrian band. You wouldn't have got that 30 years ago.
Yeah.
It was packed. So, you know, good news. Well, let's go back to the Jewish community in Brighton. What do the Jewish community think at the moment? Are they happy to stay in Brighton? Are they, you know, there's been a lot of paranoia around. I wondered, what's the view from the community?
First of all, I would say that it's not paranoia.
Okay.
I think when you look at what has gone on over the last couple of years, there is reason for Jewish people
for
to be scared.
For real concern.
Yeah, I think there is real fear. I think we're lucky here that it's not as bad as some European countries. But the fact that the synagogues all have guards on them every week, not just on the high holy days, but every week, that the police regularly patrol the synagogues and the Jewish community centre is not a positive thing. This shows the level of concern that we have, and those are very real concerns. And I think that's why the attack in Pittsburgh had such an impact on communities here, because I think we all feel that the potential of this sort of thing happening here is very real.
It's happened in Paris.
Yeah,
it's happened. It could happen here, is what you're saying.
Yeah, absolutely. There is no reason why it couldn't and
it's
why
not
it wouldn't.
Paranoia.
No, I don't think so. But
nevertheless, the community here is staying, I think, pretty much.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's growing.
Yeah.
We've got the new developments that we hope to see on Church Road. Tony Bloom, I know from the Albion, is putting quite a bit of money into that happening. The community could grow and thrive. Is that your view too?
Yes, I think that. Everybody loves Brighton.
Yeah.
So why wouldn't Jewish people want to come to Brighton? I think hopefully BNJ3 will grow and this new development will be built, and that will provide better facilities for the Jewish community. A kosher butcher, a restaurant, education for young people. And I think that's important when you're looking to attract new young families to the city. But I think Brighton and Hove, we've had a Jewish community here for 250 years. And we have contributed to society. We have had mayors, we have had the chief of police, who we honoured earlier this summer, who was the only...
He was hit with a
A coal scuttle, I think it was.
Oh dear.
But yes, murdered in post.
Nothing to do with Jewish at all.
No, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Purely criminal act. The Jewish community has always been an active part of Brighton society, and I see no reason why that would ever end. And
how do the Jewish community interact? Well, we've talked about the way you do with the interfaith and stuff like that, but the Jewish community don't, to me, seem very separate. They do seem to integrate pretty much, and you know, many people I know who are Jewish, you just don't know, you know. So how do you do it?
I think it's just who we are and what we do. I don't think communities anymore really are that insular. I think
you most, don't want to be separate.
No, I think most communities, most faith-based communities, want to integrate. That's how we learn from one another. That's how we improve the richness of the fabric of our society, by learning and sharing from one another and being part of a tapestry of cultures within the city. And Brighton and Hove certainly has its share of multiculturalism here.
Certainly does. It'd be good to have more TV shows, wouldn't it, about Jewishness, I guess, and about maybe two in different languages. You know, Hebrew, quite some people do speak in Brighton, don't they? I know I know a teacher quite well, works on this channel as well. So would you welcome that? I mean, we don't seem to have much on British mainstream TV other than in English.
I think I would like to see TV programmes in other languages. Hebrew actually wouldn't be my first choice, because I think the number of people that speak Hebrew in Brighton and Hove is very small compared to the number of people who are speaking Hindi or various dialects of Arabic. And I think actually that would really be wonderful.
Be a revolution on television.
Yeah, it really would be wonderful.
Subtitles, Hindi and then subtitles in English.
Absolutely.
It would improve this country.
Absolutely.
Yeah. What are the, you personally, what are the big things, the big changes? Obviously you want not to feel threatened at all, and that is obviously, you know, the main thing that we're here to talk about. It's terrible that you have to have guards on synagogues. That's appalling. And obviously the project in New Church Road sounds really encouraging, what with housing and new families and all this sort of stuff. What personally would you like to see happen? You must have some other thoughts on other things that the Jewish community would really like to see happen. What would they be? What would be on your list? Or have I covered them all?
I think the community would like to see new young families. It would like to see sort of a future for the community. I think, unfortunately, as in most communities, young people tend to be drawn away to the bright lights of the big cities. And I think our young people move to London, they move all around
looking
the world.
Looking for money, I suppose.
Yes, well, just new opportunities.
Sensible, yeah.
And so I think Brighton appeals to so many people, and I think it would be nice to see younger families coming, establishing themselves in the city. It would be nice to see Jewish education working. We used to have a Jewish school here.
There's been talk of another one, hasn't there?
Yeah, it would be.
Is it going to happen?
I, That I don't know. I think you have to, first of all, provide enough children who want that education, or parents who want to put their children into that education.
Okay.
I'm not always sure that single denomination schools are the best way of integrating. But I think there's a place for certainly Jewish education. But I would like to see the community grow more with younger families. And I would like to feel safer. I think, unfortunately, Jewish communities across the world at the moment are feeling quite vulnerable. And that's something that is a global occurrence, not just here. And I think, unfortunately, there has been so much talk about anti-Semitism recently in politics and outside politics that makes people feel very uncomfortable. I don't want to have people feel uncomfortable talking about the fact that they're Jewish, but I know plenty of people who are. And I think that we have allowed this undercurrent of anti-Semitism to infect daily lives. And I think that, unfortunately, most people aren't even aware that they're doing it. And I think we need to start reframing the way we talk and thinking about the language we use, and realising that words have impact on people.
Thank you very much, Fiona, for joining us today.
That's all
we've got time for. So I hope we can get you back on the vote in a few months' time, and we can see, and hopefully we will know then that the position has massively improved. Jewish community are totally, welcome, of course, in this city, and we need to improve that, don't we, really? Yeah. So join us again on the vote.